Some. Good, how are you?
What this is just an additional extension to our original disaster declaration that was issued in the middle of March. This is just essentially, it's an additional one for another 14 days, so they can get us back on the traditional every 2 week commissioner's court schedule for as long as the commissioners would like this to continue. It does adhere to the governor's order and does remove the 10-person limit on social gatherings that was issued by the governor on May 18th, I think. And so, but other than that, it's pretty
another 14 days. And the 10-day thing, as Blake said, the Texas Department of State Health Services issued a checklist of health protocols for individuals. This was back on May 18th. Removing the 10-person social gathering limitation in situations where the risk of in-person contact is minimal, we continue to recommend compliance with recommending health protocols. So we want to keep that in there. That's kind of the way we want to start operating now as we step out a little bit. Avoid large gatherings if you can. People that are older or feeling sick maybe, you don't need to be there. Social distancing, the mask, if you feel comfortable or if you're really in that 6 foot, those kind of things. Restaurants are 50% now, other things are going on. So the two main things, we've kind of gone beyond that. I think we can. So that's the purpose of this. The commissioners have been taking.
So you said the 10 or more of you is
coming
out?
Right, in situations where large gatherings can happen without people being in close contact with each other, that was issued by the state on day.
Okay. Do I have a motion to extend the county disaster declaration for another 14 days? Is there a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? And that motion carries unanimous. Agenda item 2 is to consider and take appropriate action approving the following minutes from previous meetings, the regular meeting of 14 May 2020 and special meeting of 14 May 2020. Is that a motion?
I'm going to be approving the following minutes for the May 14th regular meeting and May 14th special meeting.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Is there any further discussion?
I just want to make a note on the May 14th write-up session, if there are some questions and they've been answered by Blake. And so item number 12, we just changed the wording on that action to say, refer until the 2021 budget process when more data can be gathered for the forfeiture fund and the county budget is reviewed in August. It was changed to that way.
So do we need a new motion with that amended language? Because we're changing it, right? Are you adding it? Just adding it?
I was trying to figure out how to bring it through the process.
all COVID, but a lot. The hurricane season's coming up. The wet weather we've had recently is excellent, but it does give us some potential for flooding. So we're watching those things very carefully. Specifically, if we get a slow-moving rainstorm versus a wind hurricane or tropical storm of that nature, it could definitely put us in some categories. I'm a little extra concerned this year because I don't think people are paying as close attention to preparing for hurricane season as possible. So if you have the ability to speak to your constituents, radio, whatever else, just remind people to prepare for hurricane season, even though this pandemic, specifically their medications. If people have to evacuate their homes and don't have their medications available, it will be more difficult right now than it was in previous years because a lot of the doctor's offices are closed, the pharmacies, and there's different things going on with the COVID crisis that affects the hurricane crisis. As far as COVID-19 goes, our active cases, I'm glad to say, went down significantly today. We got an email from the state saying that four patients have now recovered. That gives us 14 active cases. We've had 32 cases since the crisis began, and 16 have recovered, and unfortunately, two deaths. We've also now updated the locations for the county to not have just total cases by precinct, but also active cases by precinct. So as you know, precinct 3 has got the most cases right now. They did have 3 recoveries today, so that's a significant improvement for precinct 3. There are several others that I'm expecting to be put up here any day now in precinct 3, so I think they're gonna start getting kind of back to normal as far as their case count goes down there in precinct 3. The issues that were causing the uptrend have been addressed locally and by the state. And things going better there. We still have one person that's hospitalized, but that person's been hospitalized for a very long time, and we've had no new hospitalizations in well over a month, and no new deaths. As far as testing goes, since the crisis has began, we've tested 347 people in Fayette County. Nearly half of those were tested this month. Test kits are more readily available now, the clinics are more familiar with testing, and PPE for the testing is more widely available. The state testing has increased due to surge teams and due to the one-day testing events that we had, and hope to have another soon. As experienced with the clinics, we decided to pause the drive-through clinic for now to focus on an upcoming effort to test all of the nursing homes in our county. All staff and all residents of nursing homes will be tested coming up soon. That looks like somewhere between 600 to 900 people to test in a relatively short period of time. So we're going to double or triple the amount of people we've tested in just a few days' time. So it's a pretty large undertaking. We had a large meeting with the nursing homes, and they said that they are not able to do that themselves. They've asked for help from the state, and we're waiting on the state to schedule that. Thankfully, we are at a low priority on the list. Unfortunately, a lot of our surrounding counties have had some outbreaks in nursing homes, and those are being placed higher on the list. If you've had some outbreaks already, if you're currently undergoing a crisis of some sort, that puts you high on the list. I'm very happy to report we've had 0 cases of staff or of residents since this began in the nursing homes, which is such a vulnerable population. Of all the deaths in Texas, 3/4 of the deaths have come from nursing homes, and they account for far less than 1% of the total population. So that's a significant trend. As far as security goes, Knight Security is working on plans to enhance courthouse security. Like many things, they've been hampered somewhat due to the COVID crisis, but plans are moving along. We have another meeting scheduled with their architect either tomorrow or Wednesday to kind of shore up any loose ends. And we are going to go with our kind of phase one we're talking about to make the courthouse more secure while still preserving all its charm and beauty. And, you know, we don't want to modernize it. It does need some shoring up as far as the security goes.
How about the numbers of testing we've done?
We've tested 347. Not all of those are residents of our county. Some people have been tested in other counties that showed up on our rolls, so there is some bleed over. But of 347 cases, we've had 32 confirmed. So of people who had symptoms, who their doctor recommended them to be tested for whatever reason, or qualified for testing under the military, We're running about 10% positive of the people who go to be tested. That's a rough estimate, and it's impossible to give you the exact number because of the bleed over from county to county.
Agenda item number 5 is consider to take appropriate action in signing a proclamation designating accepting an application for tax abatement, and an application fee from 7B Solar Ranch LLC in accordance with the tax abatement guidelines adopted by Fayette County on February 7th, 2020, and to set a public hearing date to consider and potentially enter into a tax abatement agreement and to establish a reinvestment zone as required by Texas Tax Code Chapter 312, and to authorize public notices regarding the public hearing to be placed in the newspaper. Blake, I'd like to let you say a few comments. I think we also have Mr. Evan Horn here, who's representing Candela, and you may want to add something to this discussion, this application that you're formally presenting today, which is allowed by the guidelines that we have back in February.
Right. Yeah, so what we're here to do today on this is simply to accept the application that 70 Solar is presenting to Commissioner's Court as part of the process that we require in our guidelines that we adopted back in February. There won't have to be any consideration regarding what's put into the actual application today. What we need to do is we need to set a public hearing date for that, where we will actually consider the contents of the application. So all we're doing today is accepting the application and the application fee that 70 Solar has presented, and then we can go ahead and set the hearing date, have the notices published in the newspaper.
Good to see everybody again. I'm glad to hear about Fayette County healing, and obviously we were more than cognizant we wanted to step back for a couple months so that we could get past the problem, but it's great to see that things are getting better, so I can't be here today. As Blake said, that the last step that you made was to approve the guidelines and criteria, which allows somebody that fits within those guidelines to present the commissioners with an application to consider. Along with this application was a $1,000 application fee, which Cassie did confirm the county did receive earlier this morning. So the contents of this application, much of which, if you look at the back of the guidelines and criteria that you approved, there was essentially an example application for potential applicants to use. So we took that format, we added some additional details as well for you to consider. And again, now this is the steps where the court will begin to talk about the solar farm directly. I know many of the previous steps that we talked about affected this potential solar farm, but was more for county business in general. This now is all of our discussions moving forward will be solely focused on this potential solar farm. So again, you know, we continue this project is going to be called a 7B Solar Ranch. Right? It's being developed by Candela, who I represent, but ultimately the project, if it is built, would be called 7B Solar Ranch LLC. That's why you see that as the name of the applicant. Much of what's in this application you're going to see is regarding the reinvestment zone. I know some questions have been posed at previous commissioner's court as to what is the purpose of this zone. And again, all of this is it defines the boundaries of a project, and anything within that boundary of that reinvestment zone is eligible to receive a tax incentive. It does not change the valuation of the land for tax purposes. It doesn't change the valuation of any existing property within that zone for property tax purposes. All it does is that anything within this zone is eligible. It's not guaranteed to receive an incentive, but it is eligible to receive a property tax abatement. So the first half of the application is providing a map with the proposed project boundaries, as well as an estimate of the current market value of the land within that boundary. We then go into, you'll see some exhibits, and there's some exhibits attached, which basically provide parcel information and legal descriptions of those boundaries for the county's consideration. So moving on, if this application was accepted, the next step that would be, that was in this agenda item, would be setting a public hearing to grant the reinvestment zone. So again, there's going to be notices that are going to be run with this parcel information, et cetera, defining these boundaries that the constituents of Fayette County can review and have input in if they so choose. Then we step more away from just where the project is going to be located into what the project actually is. So if you see on question 9, it's basically a general description of the proposed project. Again, what we're looking at here is a It's a solar farm with a generating capacity of 240 megawatts AC. That is also subject to change as they continue to work to find somebody to buy the power. But based on our current estimates, that is what we expect the size of the project to be. And all of our estimates for our numbers are based on the 240 megawatt project. It's going to be within about 3,800 acres. Not all 3,800 acres would be used for the project, but that general project boundary that you saw on the previous slide represents around 3,800 acres. Then again, if you want to know what comprises a solar farm, it just lists, you know, all of these things, from the panels to the mounting systems, to the underground collection tables, to the substation, to the operations and maintenance building. It's just a listing of everything that would be included if this project was to be built. We then start talking about what would be the actual investment for the solar project if it was to move forward. And again, our best estimates on a 240 megawatt project would be an additional $190 million in taxable value for Fayette County's goals. The next part is, again, we talk about jobs. We talk about this sometimes, that again, this solar farm is not going to be, this is not going to be the new Tesla truck facility where we're bringing hundreds and thousands of jobs. This will be an absolutely massive project in scope, but it actually is only going to require about 2 full-time equivalents at most in order to operate. So there will be a huge influx of temporary construction workers, which we outline there, all of which will be, you know, more than adequately compensated for their work. And then finally, like I said, I'll draw your attention to the exhibits. We talked about Exhibit A, which is, again, the kind of the defining the boundaries of the reinvestment zone, all those parcel and acreage information. We then have Exhibit B, which is probably going to be most intriguing to the commissioners. And again, based on the, this is a schedule of what we project the market values of this project to be if it was built at this 240 megawatt size. So as you can see there, expect if this project was built, it would go operational probably in late 2022. It would then hit your tax rolls at its full value in 2023 at $191 million. We then put a proposal for what we're asking for as far as the tax abatement is concerned. So you'll see taxes without abatement, right? Which is just the market value multiplied by Fayette County tax rates. And then our requested tax abatement of 75%. You can then see the sum totals of what, if this incentive was to be granted, how much tax revenues Fayette County would receive, not only during the abatement period, but also during the, once the abatement ends and the project continues to operate. So again, these are estimates based on these projects. This is what our first offer is to the county. Obviously, we, you know, if this application would be accepted, you know, all of this is negotiable, right? Statute allows for no greater than 10 years at no more than 100%, right? It could be anything else in between. You know, through my years of negotiation, we've structured deals all different sorts of ways. So what our hope to do is just work with Bay County to find a deal that best allows for this project to move forward, also while driving significant benefit for the county and its constituents. And then finally, the last benefit, again, we talked about the land, and I want to go back to this a little bit here. If all of this, that 3,800 acres that I mentioned right now, I'd say 99% of it is currently receiving, it's being valued at its agricultural use value, its productive use value, rather than its market value. If this project were to move forward, again, some subset of that 3,800 acres would no longer be used for agricultural purposes, meaning it will no longer receive that property tax benefit of being taxed at that much lower value. So what I've done here is I've drawn up what the benefit to the county specifically would be. All of the taxing jurisdictions would benefit from this, but the numbers that you're seeing here now are just for the county. So I've peeled back the 3,800 acres, and I've assumed for now, as a conservative estimate, that 2,200 of those 3,800 acres would be converted from ag back to its market value. What the county is allowed to do, or the appraisal district's allowed to do, when that conversion occurs, they can go back 3 tax years and charge interest again on the difference in taxes between the what the county collected on its agricultural use versus what it would have collected at its market value. So a good example here is that the 2019 values for that 2,200 acres, the market value of that 2,200 acres was $9.3 million. But instead of taxing on 9.3, what the county actually taxed was $133,000. That's a difference in $9.2 million in value. At your current tax rates, that would have been an additional tax of almost $43,000 plus some interest. You would get back, the county would get back $50,000 just for that year. But again, they could go back 3 years. So you would get that for 2019, for 2020, and for 2021. Meaning the county would collect just on additional land taxes $141,000. And then ongoing, they would, you would expect to receive another $45,000-ish on an annual basis, simply due to the fact that this land is going to go from ag use to its market value. So again, this application outlines those benefits. None of these things are hard and fast. None of what our proposal here doesn't commit the county to absolutely giving us that tax abatement there. But again, this is our chance to put forth our proposal and our application fee to the commissioners for your consideration. They could, yes.
So how do y'all decide, or when do y'all decide, if it's going to be a 240 megawatt, or 200, half?
Yeah, so, you know, I would say they would know 6 to 8 months before construction would actually begin. Now they're marketing this project. I mean, we've got to find somebody that's going to be willing to buy the power. And that in the market for all of that could be anywhere from 150 to 240, because that's what their interconnection capacity allows them to actually do. They can't build anything larger than 240. But what the market's saying right now is the most likely size for this project is 240. Now, for protections for both the potential agreement holder and the county, what we'll do is negotiate bare minimums within this, right? Let's say if you're going to grant a tax abatement, you have to guarantee that you're going to invest at least X. And if you don't meet that threshold, well, then all of this is null and void, because we wouldn't have agreed to this deal if you didn't at least hit this minimum number. So there are ways that we can do that. But we can build in some flexibility for the changes in size, all the while not feeling like anybody had the wool pulled over their eyes at the last minute.
Just for clarification, say you're going to build 100 megawatt.
Yep.
And then you decide to increase it after construction to 240.
Yes.
How does that play into the tax abatement?
Fantastic question. So what we tried to do on the last part of this analysis is, instead of having it set at some guaranteed payment, what we'll do is guarantee you a payment based on the size of the project. So that's this dollar per megawatt. So if it went from 100 to 240, well, then you would get, instead of 100 times 452, you would get 240 times 452. So that's why, like I said, we'll build in some bare minimum. We'll build in some bare minimum, but essentially no maximum. So if the project continues to get bigger, the county will only collect more money. Yes, the project currently cannot be built any larger than
240.
There's no minimum. No, but
minimum of the
yes, exactly. Right. There's economies of scale. Like I said, I asked them just yesterday, and I said, has this 240 number, you know, I'm going to be in front of the court tomorrow, right? Should we tell them any other number that's being considered? They've been holding fast so far to 240.
Mr.
Warren,
there's another county tax entity involved in this.
So what's happened since we last met? the, with y'all on the guidelines and criteria that happened with the school district is a similar but even more robust application had to be submitted not only to the school district but to the state of Texas Comptroller's Office. And the Comptroller's Office had to take all these facts and figures about this and essentially weigh, do they believe this project is a good deal for the state of Texas and for Flatonia, obviously. If the Comptroller says no, essentially Flatonia could not enter into the deal. But what they have done is they've actually certified, meaning they've said, we believe this is a good deal for the state of Texas and for Flatonia, and y'all can now move forward with doing an agreement. What we're hoping for the county's support on in that process is for the school district to enter into their agreement, they also need a reinvestment zone. And so what we've done is essentially we've asked for an extension on their process with the hopes that the county, Bay County, will create a reinvestment zone that then the school district can use as part of their agreement. So, like I said, all things are looking great there. The state of Texas gave us the answer that we were hoping and looking forward to receive, but we won't be moving forward with a final agreement until we, you know, continue to work with y'all.
The reinvestment zone, as it's drawn on the map, is how many acres?
That is the 3,800 acres.
Okay, and then the project boundary is 2,200.
Yes, sir.
Why is there a need to make the reinvestment zone that big if the max you're planning on going right now is 240 megawatts?
The reason is the siting even of that 240 megawatts. So if you look at that, you know, kind of the darker gray is where you would expect to see panels being placed, but that is also still subject to change. So, you know, they could move, you know, eventually a discussion with the landowner, they decided, no, I don't want it here on my land, I want it here on my land. Well, rather than confining us to some really small zone as we do it now, we're basically creating a little bit of a buffer, right? So that we don't need to come back to you twice.
And then within the zone, the only thing taken out of the ag use will be the solar area, correct?
Yes. So we'll address basically, I mean, they'll be fenced, right? Because most of the landowners here will continue to maintain whatever their farming, ranching operations are at some place. And so we'll just, the appraisal district will, you know, they'll come out to the site, we'll determine the final acreage that's inside the fence, and it's that acreage that will be converted from ag to market.
So it most likely will not be that amount of acres, because that was 2,200, maybe less than that.
No, we're thinking it's probably, in order to build a 240 megawatt project, the inside the fence, the converted area will at least be 2,200. It could be more, but we kind of want to put a conservative number out there for it.
But is that a property boundary? Where the shade area, where the solar is going to go, some of the questions we bring up, some of that is like livestock or
corridors.
Corridors or livestock or the, whatever. The
right exactly.
If they want to keep on, if they want to leave that as sort of wildlife or whatever.
Yes, exactly.
And something maybe raised the pond or something built in for that.
Exactly. Yep. And these additional taxes, of course, are not going to be borne by the landowners, right? Because those, these taxes will be borne by the project.
You've done an excellent job going through this application, and that's what this is. It's a formal application. It's not a done deal. I would stay there now and let the negotiations begin. Right? If we accept this application, if we, the court decides they won't want to do this. So it's important to leave though. This application is a public document now, right?
That's correct.
So it's important to me that if people in the public would like to view this document, they have the ability to do that. So it will be posted, this application will be posted, is that correct, on our website and made available to the public so they can look at it prior. They will have looked at it prior to our public hearing, which I think is going to be scheduled within 30 days.
We looked at the calendar, so
It'd be nice if this sheet of paper right here, it says right here that it's an estimate only, subject to change. So I almost probably think that we were negotiating something, that these are the numbers that, that something we, or this estimate they talk about, this is not an update.
That's your proposal.
That's my proposal.
That's what you would like to see happen.
Right.
And we'll study, okay?
One other question, are y'all going to, solar to new material out here on that scale? Are y'all going to provide some type of safety or, I mean, say, I mean, say first responder, emergency services going out there, because this is a new animal, and with only one person working out there, it's gonna be hard to, everybody's gonna be looking on if there's an emergency or something.
Absolutely. I would say that's probably not the hat that I wear, but what I can do is, I can probably just email it to the judge, kind of just let y'all know what general protocols are during like the construction phase, training for the local fire department, all of those things that kind of occur as the project gets ready to go into operations and then after it is, just so that if you do go with those questions, you, you can adequately provide a response to whoever's requested that you go. That does occur, I just don't know.
Yes, if I think you said July 9th.
So give you amend your motion to amend motion to set the date for the public hearing for July 9th.
I second. Is there any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries unanimous.
Thank you so much. Appreciate it.
Agenda item number 7 is to consider take appropriate action and sign a resolution concerning the Help America Vote Act and the 2020 the Coronavirus Aid Relief and Economic Security Act grant, and authorizing the Fayette County Judge to execute all documents necessary to apply for the grant.
Good afternoon, Judge and Commissioners. Reader, this is the first of three grants that we're going to be eligible to apply for. This first one is called the part of the Help America Vote Act, CARES Act, which was in response to the coronavirus. We are going to be eligible to apply for $26,000. I do have to match at 20%, which I have that amount in my contract election funds, which would cost me $5,200 to basically match that grant. We're gonna be eligible to apply for two more after this. The second one is fit. Now I'm gonna be eligible to apply for those based on the fact that I went through that security assessment about a year ago. And there's money from 2018 and then for 2019 that I'm gonna be eligible to apply for. The first one is a $40,000 grant, which doesn't require matching, and the second one is a $80,000 grant that does require a 20% match by the county. But that being said, this is the first of three that I am applying for. This money is specifically to be used to acquire equipment, supplies, personnel, anything that I need to help keep elections safe for workers and voters in 2020. And although it specifically states for the 2020 federal election cycle, I see a lot of these things that we're doing as becoming long-term processes for us in the future to help keep everybody safe, even when we're not in a pandemic such as this, because usually our elections are held in November and the flu seasons and
to provide for safe voting with respect to people's health, or is it for, well, maybe we want to have some mail-in voting here, so let's go buy some things that help us to do mail-in voting, or security, or what?
Yeah, I think, I don't know so much about security for this first one, but for the second two, for sure. The 2018 and the 2019 election security, that can definitely go for security. But for most, when you kind of, when they give you some ideas of things that you can use this first one on, they talked a lot about things to improve our voting processes, such as additional costs for printing and mailing ballots, tracking software for our mailing ballots, since we are having an increase in the number of mail ballots that are being requested. Letter opening equipment, which could help keep people from having to handle those envelopes, staffing of additional poll workers. It does say security and training, pre and post election cleaning of polling places, communications, notifying the public of processes and ballot by mail procedures, additional laptops, IT equipment, cleaning supplies, personal protective equipment. We've got a lot of those shields. We can also pay ourselves back for things that we were already purchasing in preparation for the things that were changing. So a lot of these purchases we've already made, so we can pay ourselves back on some of those things that we had already were in the process of buying. It also talks about voting equipment upgrades and replacement. So forth and so on, but it does say security enhancements to protect election processes. But security elections are, that could be a lot of things. That could be security cameras, making the courthouse more accessible. So I do believe that that we could use, if we apply for all of the grants, that we would definitely have some additional money in place for providing, which I would really like to do, since we went through the security assessment, to make some of the door downstairs. I'd like to maybe see if they would allow us to put something on it that would let people push it to open it instead of having to use the handle, since it's our ADA access and other things, maybe cameras and other things to help provide security. A lot of times we're here late at night, and so additional security to the courthouse that we could use, that Craig could monitor us from home to make sure we're safe when we're leaving, instead of having to be up here with us till 1 o'clock at night.
It was a fun night.
So yes, we can use it for those kind of things. Other questions?
You did a good job.
Thank you.
Go ahead and look. I move we sign the resolution concerning the Help America Vote Act and authorize the Fayette County Judge to execute all documents necessary to apply for the grant. Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries unanimously.
Thank you.
Agenda item 8, consider appropriate action concerning entering into an interlocal agreement between Fayette County, Texas and Washington County, Texas for road improvement services for the portion of Raymond Lane Road located in Fayette County, Texas, north of Ledbetter, Texas. AOR, isn't it, Commissioner
Kernow? Yes, it is.
You know what AOR is?
No, sir.
Your area of responsibility.
Well, that would be correct. This is, yes, we had an interlocal agreement with Washington County in the past on a road project, and we shared portions of the road. And I would like to enter into an interlocal agreement to continue to do the road project. We had built the road and paved our portion of the base and had it paved, and this is just an extension of it to come back and seal coat it, give it the final coat on the asphalt part of it. So, I move that we enter into the local agreement with Washington County for our portion of Raymond Lane Road.
Is there a second?
Second.
From an attorney's perspective, Blake, do you have anything you wanted to add?
I got chance to review it. The interlocal agreement looks looks good to me. So as long as Commissioner Court and Commissioner Smile are good with the terms, then it's fine by us.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Agenda item number 9 is to consider and take appropriate action on advanced funding agreements for the replacement or rehabilitation of two bridges off the state system between the Texas Department of Transportation and Fayette County, Texas, regarding Warner Blacktop Road over Pinot Branch and Tyner Road over Pinot Branch, increasing more.
This is just the previous meeting was the match that we were going to use for the advanced funding, and now this is the agreement to say so they can proceed with getting the projects going and the pricing, engineering, and all that. I move that we approve the advanced funding agreements for the replacement of two bridges of the off-state system through Texas Department of Transportation and Fayette County. For the bridges on Warner Blacktop Road over Pinot Branch and Tyner Road over Pinot Branch.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries unanimously. Agenda item number 10 is to consider to take appropriate action by accepting and approving the written plan of Fayette Water Supply Corporation to bore under East Harper Road in Precinct 3, and to place and install a new water service line and meter for a customer located at property ID Romeo 24979, and requiring Fayette Water Supply Corporation to make repairs of any resultant damage done to the roadway, side stitches, and right-of-way of East Harper Road, all back to a finished natural grade, and requiring Fayette Water Supply Corporation to continue to return and do paving work, compacting, restoring, monitoring the roadway, side stitches, and right-of-way of State County Road so that the county road continues to remain in the condition it was in prior to work by Fayette Water Supply Corporation. I know this is a fine road because it's in the precinct. Second. Further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
So this is number 13 and number 14 are kind of conjoining agenda items. The first one is to sign a resolution and order declaring the 2006 CPS belly dump that we currently own as a salvage and surplus property, declaring that we're going to utilize it for its trade in value. And then 14 is to take appropriate action and purchase using that trade in value to purchase the new belly dump that's listed in number 14.
Second.
Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. All opposed? Motion carries unanimous. Agenda item 15 is consider take appropriate action approving Pinky Bowes postage meter leasing agreement renewal for Fayette County Elections Office.
Yes, this is just a regular renewal, including the bottom of page one is the payment plan over a 60-month period for $25.09 per month and quarterly at $77.30 per month. And it is for the actual mail stations as well as online access to their SendPro program. I'm not super familiar with this. If the commissioners have any questions, there are questions by investigate Terry on that. I'm not familiar with the actual program itself.
Yeah, if they have to replace the machine because they are going and it's time to replace it through the company, they send a notice that it was time to be replaced.
Sure, okay.
And they took that out of circulation.
I'm going to approve this.
Second. Any further discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carries unanimous. Agenda item 16. Consider take appropriate action concerning the Fayette County Employee Health Insurance Renewal with the Texas Association of County Health Employee Benefits Group, effective 10/01/2020.
Yes, and this I'm very excited about. Again, this is the second 2 out of 3 years that we had a 0% increase on our renewal. So there will be no change in the rates. And I just wanted to point out, if you could get to the page where it shows the PPO plan and the HRA plan, the reason for our success is that there have been more people going to the HRA plan over the last couple of years. And if you look at the total amount that is paid, contributed by the county, and how many claims were paid. The PPO has more claims and contributions than the HRA has Stays the county.
Stays